Thank you very much, Cara, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank Fidelity for the generous sponsorship of our event. We really appreciate the support. We are very, very grateful. And I would like to welcome you all to our State of the College of Engineering and Applied Sciences address. This is an event that we will have it on an annual basis right now. This first one is actually quite special for me because it turns out it's close to a year since I started here last October. October 15th was my starting day, so a year ago, my wife and I were in the process of packing our stuff and getting ready to start our journey, our new journey here. And it has been indeed quite a year. It has been a year with a lot of excitement, with many surprises, most of them were pleasant, it's true, I mean, it's life, right? You always have things that happen. But most importantly, it has been a year where we laid the foundation for many new friendships and relationships that will last for a lifetime. So I would like to thank you for welcoming me here and giving me the opportunity to work in this great college with you. I have to say, as I look back in my life so far, I never had more fun than this year here coming to Stony Brook. So I mean, I'm very grateful to be here and have the opportunity to work with you. So, you know, a number of people throughout this time, they kept asking me, what does it feel like to be dean, right? So, and I don't think I had a very good answer to this, but it took me a while to sort of begin to understand the essence of this. And I think by now, almost 11 and a half months later, I have a good answer. It occurred to me that something that former President Bill Clinton said once, when they asked him what it is like to be president, that thing came to mind. So what he said is that he said, being president feels like running a cemetery. You have lots of people under you, no one is listening, all right? So I don't know about that I would extend the analogy, but the part about nobody's listening, I think it's a pretty good one. So, anyway, but on a serious note now, on a more serious note, I have to say that as I look back in everything I learned in these 11 and a half months here, there are three things that have impressed me a great deal. And first and foremost is the quality, dedication, and determination of our students. Our students are the stars of our show, and we have some amazing students here at Stony Brook. The thing that has given me a special, has filled me with a sense of purpose and responsibility, is also to see the kind of broad and diverse student body we serve and the opportunities we provide to students that come from a broad socioeconomic background. Because of the low tuition that we offer here, we give opportunities to students who would not have an opportunity to get an education of the caliber of the education that Stony Brook is providing. So I think this is something that should guide all of us in everything we do, okay? The second thing that surprised me a great deal, when I came here, I found out, before even coming here, I found out a lot about the faculty and the great work that's going on. But when I took the time to dig deeper and talk with many of you and find out about your research and so on, I was really blown away by the incredible quality and excellence of the work that's going on here at Stony Brook. We have some amazing faculty. We have an amazing talent here. And in a way, I know for a fact now that Stony Brook is a well-kept secret, Stony Brook Engineering and Applied Sciences. I think there is a lot more potential that we have here that we haven't realized it, and we need to be far more aggressive in terms of marketing and making the world know what Stony Brook Engineering and Applied Sciences is all about. And the third thing that surprised me really and impressed me is really the dedication of our staff. I think you all know, it's not a secret, that we are not the most well-resourced college in the university or the country for that matter in terms of staff. But we have some staff that are extremely dedicated. They make this college work because of the hard work and the extra effort, the long hours and so on. So I would really like to ask everybody here who is from the staff to please rise. And I want us to give them a round of applause to appreciate them as a small token of our appreciation. Please, please, whoever is from the staff. Thank you so much. The college could not run without everything you do. Specifically, I would like to thank Lisa Giunelli, Kelly Dowling, and Vincent for helping to organize this event. They've done an amazing job to put this together. So thank you very much. So let me start with kind of the formal talk of my presentation. I want to take a few minutes and sort of talk a little bit about the general context, the national challenges really that confront colleges of engineering all around the country. And perhaps the most important sort of national challenge, which sadly you're not going to hear much discussion in the current political debates and so on, because who cares about this, right? It's this so-called innovation deficit. Okay, this is an economy, it's a global world, global economy. Economic leadership depends on technological leadership, and that requires significant investment in research and education, actually. And the term innovation deficit refers to the fact that the U.S. really is falling rapidly behind in at the level of federal investment that is needed, federal and state investment to support higher, higher education institutions. And you see this cartoon here highlighting exactly this race with countries like South Korea, China, the European Union, and so on, where we are already falling significantly behind. And this graph actually, it's pretty much makes the case very, very clearly. The what you see here is the investment throughout the years, millions of dollars going into R&D, and this is kind of what historically what has happened here in the U.S. This is what it would be required if we were to keep up in terms of what China is doing per scale with our GDP. This is the kind of investment that would require to stay in parallel with China. And of course, actually, South Korea is right now, it's not in this graph, but I think they're even higher than China in this. And this is pretty much what the sequestration is doing to this type of investment, right? And there are different scenarios in between. The bottom line is there is a gap, and the gap is spreading, and it has tremendous implications for the economic leadership of the U.S. in the future. And it also helps us understand what we do as educators, really, that our work is not important only for what we do for our own research, for our students. What we do here is important for the national interest. We have a national level responsibility. And I think you cannot really highlight this even more clearly than in this graph. Again, highlighting this innovation deficit in terms of the number of degrees. So what you see here is the percentage of degrees in science and engineering in each country. And the red is engineering degrees. So China, for instance, is in 35, close to 40% of the degrees every year are in science and engineering. 32% of these are in engineering. And you see where the US is, actually. We are way down here. So this is really very, very serious issue, okay? And as I said, these are some of the issues that you'll never hear in a political campaign, perhaps because they are too serious and they may be considered on the boring side, right? But this is really important for us to remember. And what makes things even more challenging is, of course, what universities face around the country right now. Is this, especially the public institutions, public higher education in the US, is getting less and less support from the states. What this graph is, this is actually shows on the blue here, is the enrollments, student enrollments, public. This is aggregate for all public universities in the US, all right? And so the number of students is going up, the state investment and in total billions, and this is in per FTE, there's a huge decline, right? So this is really what public institutions are asked to do today. They ask to do something to help fill this innovation deficit that there is, but they have to do it with a lot less. I have to say that New York actually it does not follow the national trends. We are, although in New York there has been decline of state support, we're doing much better than many, many other major public universities around the country. But nevertheless, this is the context in which public institutions have to work today. And even though the state support is not as, it has not declined as much as it has in other states here, we are facing our own budget limitations here. There are a number of, SUNY 2020 has not been renewed and there is uncertainty. There are budget cuts. We have to absorb raises and so on. And the point is besides the point here, but the bottom line is we too have to operate in an environment where we are having shrinking resources. And in order to highlight this, I want to dedicate like two slides to sort of a 50,000 foot view of the budget of the College of Engineering and Applied Sciences. And when I say College of Engineering and Applied Sciences, I don't only mean the Dean's Office. What you see here are aggregates for the entire college, so all the departments together. So what this is actually these bars indicate how much money we need to make the college run every year. Okay, so you see here from 2012 to 2016-17, the red is actually what the provost provide. Okay, the blue is what the provost provide. The red is actually what the deficit we start with every year. All the departments have the same problem. The dean's office has the same problem. This is the money we need to raise. Okay, the point is that unless we are able to raise revenue, we are not able to keep the college running. That's the reality that we face, and that's the reality in which we have to operate. And how do we raise this revenue? Again, this is a pie chart representative of the entire college, again, showing so you saw this red column there. How do we cover this, whatever, $6 to $7 million deficit that we have every year? We cover it from tuitions from master's revenue, from IDC return, summer programs, winter classes, research tuition on research grants and so on. The bottom line is that unless we are willing to teach in the summer and in the winter, which also serves a second purpose of relieving some of the pressure for classrooms and teaching resources throughout the year in the face of increasing enrollments, unless we are willing to start master's programs and offer this to students, unless we grow our research expenditures, we cannot keep the college running. And most importantly, we cannot take the college to the level that we want to be. Okay, so that's the message I want you to take from this, that we are in an era where resources are shrinking and we have to rely more and more on our own capability to generate resources. And of course, this happens, to make things more interesting, in a time of unprecedented student growth, right? So I think you all have seen these graphs. This is our undergraduate growth from 2008 onward. We crossed 4,000 threshold this year. The graduate student, the number has leveled off and slightly declined this year. And what you see here is the little blue bars here are the SUNY Korea students. SUNY Korea is growing. Right now there's about 500 students. We had 64 of SUNY Korea students that came to our campus. That's what I have mentioned here. But this number is to grow because we have new programs, applied math and statistics. In addition, is starting. We are trying to start new programs and so on. So this is going to grow, even though it's still a small number. But there is growth there. So in fact, the growth of our students has been stunning in the last few years, and we've taken the time to try to analyze this to see what it means in context to some of our peer AAU universities. So you see here a graph that shows the growth of enrollments on average AAU universities compared to our students, and essentially we are leading the AAUs. Our students are growing 2.6 times faster, the student numbers, than the other AAUs. The same thing happens in graduate degree productions. We are growing, so we are actually doing our part in terms of closing this innovation deficit in spite of the limited resources and the challenges that we face there. It's important to understand that the last 5 years we rose from 53 to 37 in highest production of bachelor's degrees in the US, from 41 to 32 in highest production of master's degrees in the US, and from 50 to 37 in highest production of PhD degrees in the US. This is amazing growth. And what is the most incredible thing of all is actually this has not happened at the expense of quality. To the contrary, we have grown our student numbers and quality of students has exploded. So what you see here is the growth of SAT and GPAs of our freshman class. And you can see that these things keep going up. We actually took the time to really compare our students, the freshmen we admit, the SAT scores, with a number of peer universities. And what you see here is that actually Stony Brook right now is more selective than Ohio State, Rutgers, NC State, Delaware, University of Washington, of course SUNY Buffalo, Penn State, and so on. So we are actually getting here at Stony Brook some of the best and the brightest engineering students in the nation, okay? And that's something all of you deserve the credit for the great work you're doing. But it's also a sense of responsibility for us that we want to continue this growth in quality and make the quality even higher. Now, if we want to take a look and see where we are in terms of our peer institutions and aspirant institutions, the university is recognizing a group of universities that are considered peer and others that we aspire to be. So I have compared Stony Brook here with these other universities. This is essentially the number of engineering degrees awarded in 2015-2016. And you see actually that, again, as I said, we are doing our part in terms of narrowing this innovation gap as far as students is concerned. Where we are in terms of degrees granted to women, of course, diversity is a very, very important issue, and it is something that the college and all of you I know take very, very seriously. So as far as undergraduate degrees, you see, relative to peer institutions, we are significantly above average, but we still have quite a bit of work to do because 22% is quite far off 50%. Masters, we are a lot higher, and actually quite high in PhDs. Again, these numbers are promising, encouraging, but we have ways to go. This, by the way, is just 14-15 numbers. This is not kind of, it's just for a snapshot for a year. When it comes to underrepresented minorities, our numbers are not as strong, but actually we are not, as far as the undergraduate level, actually, again, we are at the middle of the peer institutions and somewhat higher. But again, this is an area where we have a lot of work to do, especially on the graduate and PhD. I mean, this is a kind of a singularity because this is just a snapshot from a year. But clearly, when it comes to masters and PhDs and even undergraduate degrees in underrepresented minorities, we have a lot of work to do. And of course, what is interesting about our students, the composition of our students, is the ethnic diversity. We have the international aspect of our students. We are second in terms of international percentage of students after Purdue in masters, and we actually lead in PhD production, okay? So this is kind of in a snapshot the composition of our student body, and I think these numbers are important as we think strategically for the future, but it's also important to understand, and I want to highlight that our students are just amazing students, okay? And I could spend a lot of my talk here highlighting the excellence of our students. I have picked here Morgan DiCarlo from civil engineering, not only because she was just phenomenal, but because she was one of the graduates of our new civil engineering program, that department that graduated its first group of students last spring. And all of them were remarkable. I mean, Morgan represents really what the kind of the quality, the excellence of the students. They all went on to find jobs or to be placed in great graduate schools. Or like our Goldwater Award winners, like Michael Agati from Electrical and Ioana Soaita from Biomedical Engineering. We have amazing students. And that was the first thing, as I said, when I came to Stony Brook, when I realized the excellence of the students, it filled me with a great sense of responsibility. And one of the first things that we did is to recognizing the growth, the excellence of the students, we had to make a change very quickly and make sure we create space for the undergraduate office so that the students get the advising that they deserve in a space that it is actually commensurate to their excellence, right? The previous space, which was right next to the dean's office, it was oversaturated with students. There were no privacy there and so on. So we made fairly quickly a change. We moved to 231 engineering. I think most of you have seen the space. The space is much larger. It still needs quite a bit of work and renovation. We spent $100,000 to bring it up to speed so that we're able to move there and start using it. We have a plan for another $400,000 investment that we are working to raise the money from philanthropy and state grants to actually be able to get it to the level that it should be. We took significant steps to strengthen our commitment to women in STEM. WISE has been an incredibly successful program, and under the leadership of Kerri-Ann Miller and the rest of the WISE team has done incredibly well, but we thought that this is a program that's so successful that deserves for the college to invest more. So Professor Monica Bugaggio from Electrical and Computer Engineering has been appointed as the first faculty director of WISE, and she's going to start working with Kerri-Ann and her colleagues actually to take WISE to the next level of excellence. The college is putting incentives into WISE and incentives to grow sponsored funding in STEM. because I think WISE can play a role not only to bring great students, great women students to engineering, but also contribute to increase research funding, both funding in STEM, but also general research funding through providing opportunities for outreach and broader impact. So there's a lot of opportunity for win-win synergies. WISE, for that, our goal is to seek to actively engage faculty to take ownership of the program. We're going to be setting up a faculty advisory board from other colleges so that there is a broad representation, since WISE serves a number of colleges around campus. And we have a new web pages which Carrie Ann and her team put together, and I really appreciate that. And so again, in terms of trying to publicize and showcase, there is a great web media. Our college is really showing remarkable leadership in educational innovation for underrepresented minorities. This is an area where we need a lot of work, but luckily this is an area where, under the leadership of David Ferguson in Technology and Society and his STEM Smart umbrella of programs, I think places us in a unique position to lead in STEM and diversity. For that, we have undertaken a major focus area for the college is engineering education for a technology-driven society. We are focusing on working on a range of programs and new educational initiatives, on programs that fuse engineering with arts, business, and journalism. The main focus is thinking of the students in the era of exponential technologies, intelligent machines, robots. We really need students that can think globally, thinkers, tinkerers, innovators for the global economy. We're going to focus on developing a program on engineering entrepreneurship, and of course a major program on engineering for social good. We are about to launch this CAS Turkana Basin Institute, the summer school already. We are planning courses with mechanical engineering, civil engineering. The college is going to be putting resources in that. There's a lot of excitement across the university for doing this, where we're going to get engineering students to work with, to solve problems that are confronting the people that live in the Turkana Basin area right now through technology, problems related to clean water, energy, and so on. Great students, but great students could not be educated without great faculty, and we have superstar faculty in this college, okay? So I will spend a few slides here to celebrate some of them. So computer science, they had a fantastic year, five faculty, and you see them all here, win prestigious Google Research Awards in 2016. I think we are one of the very few departments that can say nationally that we had this type of success. We had three career award winners, two from computer science, one from material science and engineering. And again, our career award winning young faculty are just, the numbers every year we have steady 3, 4, 5. We have a number of, 30, 40 career award winners in our faculty. And this is a very steady production. It really shows the excellence that has come into the college and bodes well for the future growth. And by the way, I don't know how many of you realize this. How many colleges do you think have in the ranks a faculty member that has its own trading cards, right? Well, we actually have one. And it is no other than Esther Takeuchi, who this year actually got her face on the Electrochemical Society scientist trading cards. I don't know if you noticed, this is someone by the name of Michael Faraday here. I don't know who that is, but if you're interested, Esther will be signing autographs on the way out and giving you the card. So we are really proud to have faculty of this caliber in our college. We had a great year in terms of hiring. Even though most of them were lines we replaced, some of them were new lines, continuing of the SUNY 2020 hire, which kind of stopped right now. But we have a number of people. We have hires in biomedical engineering, biomedical informatics, civil engineering, computer science, material science engineering, and mechanical engineering. Most of these folks are here. Some of them are coming a little later, but I would like to welcome you all to the College of Engineering and Applied Sciences and wish you the best in your career here. This has been a great year as far as rankings is concerned, although you can't celebrate much for rankings because they're going to change the next year. But as far as the college rankings, the collegiate rankings, we have experienced a steady growth. So in the last 2 years, 3 years, we have gone up from 69, 66 to 62. I've put here as a reference Buffalo. which is the other big Sunni school, and Buffalo, in contrast, they have kind of stayed steady and declining a bit. So we are, I think, within striking distance to become the best in Sunni, but this is not really our aspiration. Our aspiration is to be one of the 50 best engineering colleges in the country, and I think we have the capabilities to do that. And I understand that rankings, you know, sometimes you say, why bother? They are kind of erratic and so on. It is true, but let's not forget that we all do not like the rankings until we start ranking high there, right? When we start ranking high, then we all want to showcase the rankings. When we are not doing so well, then we try to say that, well, they are flawed, and they are flawed, they are not perfect. Nevertheless, they provide a metric, and nevertheless, as far as the college level goes, there is a quantitative formula, which I'll talk about in a minute. And there are things that we can work to improve our rankings in a strategic and deliberate manner. So, just as a comparison in terms of peer universities, one can ask the question, for instance, how are we doing in terms of size? Is our size something that would prevent us from rising in the rankings? Again, college-wide. So what you see here is, again, this peer and aspirant universities, and this number is the ranking in US News Report of the college, okay? And these are the faculty, and you have different types of faculty. You have tenure track, you have research, you have teaching faculty in each college. The bottom line is that where we are right now, you know, I think we are at about 170 plus full-time tenure track faculty. I think our steady state should be close to 200, but I don't think the size is really a limiting factor here for us. I think perhaps the previous stage of the college, the 100, 110 was kind of limiting, but we're getting to a point where, especially if we are able to grow to get to a steady state of about 200 faculty, will be in good shape. So I spoke about the US News ranking formula, which is important to highlight here. I mentioned that the formula, when it comes to ranking of colleges, the formula is actually quantitative. Okay, so there is a formula, there is data that goes into an equation that gives you the ranking somehow. And the US News makes this formula known. So what you see here is sort of the pie that determines our score. The size of its slice is actually the relative significance of this metric to the overall score. So for instance, peer assessment and recruiter assessment, so a subjective metric accounts for 45% of the final score, right? But very significant is research expenditures per faculty. So if you look at this piece of the slice, which is research related, it is a big chunk. A number of graduate students per faculty, PhDs granted, mean GRE scores, quality of our graduate students, important student acceptance rate, and so on. The colors here highlight where we are relative to our peers. So for instance, when it comes to graduate students and PhD granted and quality of graduate students, we are much better than our peers, the universities that are around us in the rankings and we're trying to overtake. So we actually, if mean GRE was the only metric, the college would rank number 25, for instance, as an example. But if it comes to research expenses per faculty, we would rank 107, all right? So that right away tells you some of the things that we need to improve. We have to really take care of our research expenditures. We need to market the college much, much better than what we do, okay? So this type of data-driven approach does provide some useful insights. So speaking of research expenditures, this is what the college looks like over the last 8 years. We have been growing. There is a spike here, presumably related to stimulus infusion of funding to universities around the country. There was a big drop after that, and now we are rising. Now, I have to say that we are the only college in Stony Brook that actually has a positive. Yesterday I was at an event, I was talking to SUNY Provost, Alex Cartwright, and he said, you know, you have to do something at Stony Brook to fix your research expenditures. But he said, your college is doing well. I said, yeah, we're doing well because we grow, but we are at $32 million for a college of 170. So we have long ways to go, all right? But the good thing is the positive derivative here, and we need to keep this up, and we need to steepen that slope. So just as an indication, this is really what we got in 2016, where it came from. So you kind of get a sense of where our funding comes from. So NSF and NIH type of work is over 50% of the funding that comes to the college. So these agencies are very, very important. DOE, Department of Defense, industry, New York State, and so on. So that's an indication, I think, of in terms what is the type of funding that that comes to the college. And it allows us also to see things strategically in terms of what agencies we focus and other areas that we can grow. I think, for instance, Department of Energy should be an area that we need to grow. And there has been a lot of growth recently because of a number of grants. We need to sustain this and grow it further. If you look at the work that is happening in this college, it's really science fiction coming to life. And it is science fiction coming to life for a purpose, for the purpose of benefiting society, improving the human condition, and help sustaining humanity. So we're sort of trying to make this as a big kind of focus of our college. We have we put in quite a bit of work to revamp our web pages. I think there's a big progress from where we started last year to where we are now. We're nowhere near where we want to be, but I have to say that, and I want to thank Christine Cesaria here for the fantastic work that has done with a very small fraction of her time that computer science department generously agreed to provide to the college. She has transformed really our communications. So we're in the process of hiring a communications director, so I think this is only going to get better. We have launched for the first time our e-newsletter, which goes out to engineering deans, department chairs, alumni, the industry. And I'll be challenging, and I have already challenged the department chairs to start doing the same thing for their department in a very systematic way. We had the opportunity to, through the leadership of David Ferguson, to actually get the ASCE TV to come to Stony Brook and do a video, which was got a lot of publicity at the ASCE conference in New Orleans June or early July, I think. And this video is online. It's a great showcase of the type of work that is going on here. And we have tremendous excellence to highlight, right? Many of the work of our faculty made international headlines, okay? So I'll highlight few, and I'll highlight studies that have made it to high-profile journals like Nature and so on. So Song Hu and Wei Zhu from Applied Math and Statistics, working together with Yusuf Hanan and others from the Cancer Center, their Nature paper on showing that 80% of cancer cases are caused from environmental factors was a huge blockbuster. Alan Tenenbaum and his group published very influential work in Nature Scientific Reports highlighting using the mathematics of networks to uncover vulnerabilities of cancer. Dima Kozakov from Applied Math and Statistics recently had a paper in PNAS reporting some tremendous computational advances that allow you to model proteins much faster, and this is going to speed up drug development. Alex Orlov, just a couple of weeks ago, had his work highlighted on the Department of Energy webpage. So some new developments in catalyst research and so on that is going to have major impact in energy and environmental applications done in collaboration with BNL. The bottom line is, there is a lot of material I'm trying to cover, and I don't want to, I could fill the whole talk with success stories of our faculty. The point is, we have tremendous excellence here, and we need to be aggressive in showcasing it. I think you already know our team, but I want to highlight again our new associate deans, Rob Kukta, associate dean for undergraduate studies, Samir Das, associate dean for research and operations, and Yuan Yang, Young, Associate Dean for Diversity and Faculty Affairs, Kelly Dowling, Assistant Dean for Advancement, and of course Jennifer, who is not new, but she kind of makes the place run, so she has to be there, okay? Well, it's true, when it comes to undergraduate education, you know, she is the heart and the mind of the place. So there has been a major kind of historic change of guard in the electrical and computer engineering surge after 22 years of excellent service has stepped down as chair, and I would like to take the opportunity to thank Serge. I think he's here somewhere for his service. He has led the department steadily and focusing on excellence. And now Peter Juric, as of late August 2016, he is the new chair, and we wish him the best. We have spent a lot of time building the staff to support our growth. Kelly Dowling's advancement team, we have hired Min Am Mandhian and Vincent Accardi And we have one more position, another director of development in process. We are about to complete this hire. So we have a great team now, and we are hitting the ground running in terms of fundraising. The Dean's Office, Lisa Giunelli, my assistant, Rachel Ingracia is the assistant director for finance and management, and our new advising staff, Jacqueline Bello. We have three searches underway, director of communications, proposal manager, international advisor. These searches, by the way, communications director and proposal manager are going to be shared services across the whole college. And the searches are quite advanced. We are either the interviews are finished or we are in the second round of interviews and so on. So we hope in the next couple of months to have these positions filled. And we have plans for future searches, director of laboratories and undergraduate advisors. We have been growing. We have new programs. We have programs that are in space that is substandard. So one of the first things we had to work on here is to try to find the renovate space for supporting our growth. So we are in the process of completing the renovation of a 17,900 square feet in the old computer science building to house Tech and Society, the house civil engineering and biomedical informatics. And this was the total project cost was $1.5 million. Half of it was contributed by the provost and half by the college. But this is good quality space that I think it's important for the college. We have taken a number of initiatives to strengthen the culture of excellence in the college and build a vibrant community of scholars, because these are key elements of building a leading college of engineering and applied sciences. So we are in the process looking at revising the promotion and tenure policy to reinforce excellence. And this is something that is in the process right now and something that is going to go into effect for the next, in the next 3 years, because there is some time that we recognize that a number of faculty are in the promotion stages, and this has to be fair and give enough time for people to adjust to these new guidelines. We have developed and placed in effect mentoring guidelines for junior faculty. Junior faculty is the best, the most important investment we have made. We need to make them feel welcome. We need to guide them to be successful. We cannot afford them to not be wildly successful. So this is something that is already in effect. We are instituting a culture of performance review. So I think all of you had the opportunity to review your chairs. I'm having meetings with your chairs, communicating this feedback that you all provided. The chairs will be asked to have meetings with all of you on a yearly basis, make sure that we have, in order to build this vibrant community of scholars, accountability and making sure we set goals and we meet them is very, very important. We are looking into faculty obligation guidelines to make sure that we have a balance between teaching, research, and service, which is something that we're going to be unrolling in the next few months. Finally, we are taking steps to foster cross-disciplinary research. So we have a number of CAS-led but Stony Brook-wide workshops, and we are working to create seed funding opportunities to stimulate large grants. Speaking of interdisciplinary research, we put a lot of emphasis actually trying to develop the new vision of the college, and all of you had the opportunity to participate, and it's something that is still ongoing. We identified a number of initiatives, energy systems of sustainability. These are for sustainability. These are initiatives that cut across the whole college, and number one. Number two, provide opportunities for our college to lead Stony Brook as a whole, okay? And recognize the strengths that we have in different areas. Smart and resilient cities and ecosystems, engineering-driven medicine, securing cyber everything, and of course the engineering education for technology-driven society. We are in the process right now of starting these cross-cutting workshops. A number of them have already taken place, where I call them the engineering serendipity workshops, because this is what it is. It's about engineering serendipity. We are bringing people together. The idea is to bring people from across the college and across the university to go first through a speed dating phase, where they take 5 minutes to talk about the stuff they do in the topic of interest, and then have breakout sessions where true magic happens. And you see here some images of two of these workshops. So the energy systems for sustainability took place in late July, and it was led by Devinder Mahajan, Eugene Feinberg, and our associate dean for research, Samir Das. We have 50 plus people that came. We had terrific ideas that came out of these breakout sessions. A number of people came to me and said, I had no idea that X and such and such was actually doing this work. And this is the idea. Rather than having to go to conferences by accident, meet a colleague of ours who is working in a great area right next door, we have to make this happen here. And I do plan to institutionalize this, where we every year we have opportunities to come together and just talk about what we do. And that's where the true magic happens. We had another workshop on smart and resilient cities and ecosystems that took place in August 20. Over 40 participants were there. There were people from engineering, from SOMAS, and so on. So Dimitri Samaras, Hal Walker, and Samir Das organized this. They are developing white papers based on this, and we're working to get seed funding to start some initiatives in all these areas. A big initiative underway, which are in the early stages of planning right now, is the Engineering Driven Medicine Institute, which is in collaboration with Stony Brook School of Medicine and the college, of course. This is recognizing the fact that this is the era of convergence of engineering, medicine, and physical sciences, transforming the future of healthcare. This is in recognition of the fact that Stony Brook has indeed been a leader already in leading in convergent science. Our biomedical engineering department and our more recent biomedical informatics department are great examples of convergence departments. What we want here is to recognize that now it's essentially people from all fields of engineering. Technology is in a profound way changing medicine. And we want to create a vehicle, actually, an institute that will maximize the potential impact that we can have. So there's going to be focus on research innovation for personalized medicine and global health. Education, thinking of how do we educate the new breed of clinicians who will have to deal with this explosion of technology, and how we educate the new generation of convergent scientists. Who will have to be able to really produce the new technological breakthroughs. And of course, economic development and entrepreneurship, really, part of all these technologies that will be produced there. We have already started initiatives under this in collaboration with the Lawfare Center and the Cancer Center. We have started this initiative on engineering and cancer and biology nexus. There is a small group of faculty that's creating an RFP. The RFP, there is seed funding that we have raised. The RFP is going to go out and it's going to ask all of you to participate in workshop and engage in forming teams to write proposals. We envision this to be the model for all the areas that we are developing there. And of course, we are working with the Global Health Institute really on innovations and technologies for delivering healthcare to impoverished communities around the world. So, our vision, I think, is bold and far exceeds what we can pay for, actually. That's the unfortunate part. So we need to raise the money. I mean, it's as simple as that. And that brings me to the campaign for the College of Engineering and Applied Sciences as part of the campaign for Stony Brook. What I have here is how we have been doing so far every year in terms of the amount of money we have been raising. This is actually this year when Kelly Dowling came on board. One thing you'll notice is that the performance is actually, there are a couple of spikes, and these spikes are the only years where apparently the college had somebody taking care of fundraising, okay? So you see the tremendous impact of having somebody actually who is doing this. And so far, whenever this happened, we had one person. Right now, we have four people already. The rest are years where things kind of left on their own. And obviously, we have not been doing quite well, but I'm optimistic that things will change. And I hope every year from now on to put this graph up and upgrade it with a column that gets higher and higher and higher. When I came here, I found out one of the surprises that I was telling you, that as part of the Far Beyond Stony Brook campaign, engineering has been tasked to raise $37 million for over 7 years. Okay, and I also found out that at the time we had raised a little more than $8 million. Okay, so the bottom line is we raised some more this year. The bottom line is we have to raise $28 million in 21 months. So 75% of the funds in 25% of the time. That's a nice surprise. But and what is even more interesting is that we have to build this fundraising process. It doesn't happen overnight. You have to identify your key alumni. You have to cultivate them. You have to reach out to them. They have to get them to trust you and believe in your vision. So we are doing all this right now, and I'm optimistic that I don't know if we'll be able to meet our goal, but what I told President Stanley is that I know that what we're doing now will position the college in a place to explode during the second campaign that will follow the first one. Because from the time I have spent talking to our alumni, we have tremendous potential, a lot of dedicated alumni that just have not been cultivated, and we just need the work, and Kelly and her staff are doing this work. So as far as fundraising priorities, we have a lot of money to raise in a very short period of time. We need to focus on big ideas. We want big gifts. We want ideas that highlight how our work transforms society and makes a difference in the world. So that's where we are focusing. So anyway, as I come to the end of my talk, I would like to summarize with some of the challenges in terms of looking ahead right now, some of the biggest challenges that I think confront us. Challenge number one, how do we support sustainable enrollment growth and at the same time produce quality education, inventing the future of education, right? Our enrollments are growing. How do we sustain that, and how we also invent new initiatives and implement them? And how do we realize our quite broad cross-cutting research vision? The answer, of course, to that is that we have to grow the pie. There is no other magic bullet there. We need to grow the pie. So we have to pursue philanthropy, as I mentioned. We have to grow our research expenditures, and to this end, the college is prepared, and the university, by the way, I hope soon I'll have some things to announce, to invest seed funds to stimulate large grants. Growing our research expenditures is not going to happen with $50,000 grants, which is, it's good and we want them. It's really faculty taking leadership to develop big scale grants, multi-million dollar grants, which we definitely have the capacity and the capability to do this, and I'll talk a little more about this. We need to increase tuition revenue we generate from masters online, summer, and so on, while we keep the quality high. We need a new engineering building, all right, because our growth is really requires new space and new quality space to really be able to realize our educational vision. The good news is that the engineering building is right now at the very top of the university's priority list for state funding, okay? That is the case, I have been assured by that, and of course we have to wait. I mean, things can happen, this is New York politics until, so there's, we have a long way, but we're in the best position we've ever been. I don't know, I can not guarantee what is gonna happen. It's something that does not entirely depend on me, although we have spent quite a bit of time meeting with key people, having the, like Senator Laval, bringing the staffers to see the college, highlighting the needs that we have here. I think things are going well, but we have to wait and see. And of course, what I see here is a tremendous opportunity, because in order to realize all of this, we have to show how we add value to the enterprise that's called Stony Brook University. And we have to do this by leveraging our excellence to provide leadership across the entire university, to develop high-impact engineering-driven research initiatives. And as I hope I highlighted before, that's what we are trying to do. So my final slide is really what I want to, some core values that drive me in every decision I try to make, and I would hope that they guide all of us. We strive to become an elite college, okay? And by that, I'm not really, there are many ways to characterized an elite college, but elite college is really one that performs high impact research that helps transform society and improve the world, okay? That's the bottom line. The rest, the rankings and so on, they all follow. Is our work really of value? Is it important? Do we make a difference? So in every decision that I make, I try to follow these core values, and I thought that they are important for me. It's important for me to share them with you. Am I keeping the excellence bar rigid and high? And I think this is something that we have to ask ourselves from everything. Every paper we write, every grant we submit, whenever we go to class and teach a class, when we consider promotion and tenure, when we are a staff member and we try to support an initiative that is going on, are we delivering excellence in everything we do? Do we take steps to foster a community of scholars, to mentor people, to make them feel welcome, engaged, to have cross-cutting ideas fertilized here and lead to big, exciting initiatives? Do we lead in inventing the future of engineering education, or we just follow? Do we foster and lead in cross-cutting societally relevant research? We need to think entrepreneurially in everything we do, whether it is in doing fundraising and advancement, or how we support our teaching missions, our research missions, how we support our own research programs. We need to think entrepreneurially. I showed you before that we have to do more for less, and we have to keep raising resources to do that. We need to be globally focused, but also make a difference locally. We have to promote diversity and intercultural understanding. And of course, we have to aggressively market our excellence, okay? Nobody's gonna do it for us. And last but not least, we need to do anything we can to fight complacency. I think this is the biggest enemy of all. Often we tend to look at ourselves and say, you know what, we're actually the best department in the College of Engineering and Applied Sciences. We're doing well. Or we are the best college in the Stony Brook University. We really need to think where our eye is. Our eye should be on our target, and our target is to reach national prominence, to be one of the 50 top engineering schools. So we have to be looking outward, compare ourselves with our peers, and never be complacent until we realize our goal. And when we realize it, we have to stay there. So fighting against complacency is actually the most important thing. So with this, I would like to end by saying that the stage of our college is strong, but I really, really believe that our best days are yet to come. Thank you for your attention.